and sanctioned ideas which other people haven't got within their industry in a new way. She's been very, very successful in doing that, but also working very closely with politicians over the years to try and sort of bridge the gap between really hard problems and really important problems, because the food industry is enormous. And her work really involves ultrasound and acoustics, and Valerie's been very much at the heart of a lot of theory work and helping out with this as well. And recently, maybe we've been doing things on the importance of sound on human appreciation of food. And I remember hearing her talk at your time, there was an app in the crunch of the food. So there's a lot more to food science, as well as the processing and the inspection of the appreciation of it. So I hope you'll manage to bring those theory and practice together. Thank you very much. And I should say, over to you, Professor.
Thank you very much indeed. That sounds very nice. I like it. So thank you for that lovely introduction, Dave. Carefully padded to fill the time available, which is so good. So what we're going to try and do now is to give you a bit of an insight into the sort of systems that we've been studying with the ultrasound, but we very much want to make links with the foundations of the theory that you've been hearing about this week, particularly Dave and Paul's talks. Sorry, Sonia, we haven't got anything periodic in here. But we'll just try and bring that out as we go along. So this is what we're going to do. I'm just going to show you the structure of multiple scattering theory as we use it in our systems, before Megan shows you some of the actual measurement systems that we use, what they look like, how they work, and what we need to be aware of when we're working in these real systems rather than our theoretical concepts. And then we'll show you some examples of the sorts of materials that we have been working on and what you can deduce from them using the multiple scattering model. And particularly, I think we can show where you need to be careful with your models, and where the models don't work can be the most interesting, because then that's telling you something about, something extra about your system beyond its scattering nature as well. So let's just start with the multiple scattering theory, but I'll give you the foundations in terms of what sorts of systems we're working in, so you know what we're what the systems are to start with. So generally speaking, we are looking at materials which are liquid-based. They're liquid continuous systems, and so that liquid is homogeneous. A lot of the systems we use that would be water, but it doesn't have to be. And then the scatterers themselves are some kind of particles. They could be solid particles, they might be liquid droplets, they could be bubbles, they might be molecules themselves, single molecules in solution, and they can be crystals, or the emerging crystals, as we will see later. And the measurements are ultrasonic spectroscopy, so that's where we look at a range of frequencies together. So we have some ultrasound property as a function of frequency, or we might be using velocimetry, where we're measuring the speed of sound, specifically the effective speed of sound in our theories. And just to bear in mind, when I'm talking about ultrasound, that is a longitudinal compressional wave. I'm not just going to talk about pressure waves, actually, that complication will come later on. So here's a little diagram of what the stuff might look like. So imagine some kind of can, sample, whatever dish with your slurry liquid mush in it. So I've given you some examples there. So in terms of the theory, we're looking at spherical scatterers. We're looking at semi-infinite homogeneous material, which is our embedding medium. And the way we are using multiple scattering is to look at multipole expansion. So we're taking those, the spherical form of the Hankel function that Paul referred to earlier in the week, and I'm in the camp which says Bessel functions are my friend. And so we're using those outgoing Hankel functions for our scattered waves. And then we're going to move into something that we've not really covered this week, although Paul did mention it, I think David did too, which is to take ensemble averages. so that we can average over all different possible physical configurations of our scatterers. Very specifically, we are using linear acoustics, nothing too frightening here, non-linear, we leave to those clever people who are doing the non-linear tomography program, but we work with linear here, and we're not going to cover anything which is resonant specifically in this talk. And predominantly, the examples I'm going to show you are in the Rayleigh regime, so we're talking about the wavelength being much larger than the size of any of our scatterers. It's not exclusively the case, but it is mostly the case. And I've just added a note on the bottom, which I'll come back to, which is that we need to bear in mind the effects of viscosity and of thermal conduction, and particularly in the continuous liquid phase. So how does that model structure work? Well, on the left here, you've got, so here's our pot of stuff, and here's what an ultrasonic transducer might look like. So we've been introduced to piezoelectric materials earlier, and that's often what we use here for our transduction. So you send an electrical signal, that produces a displacement, and that will travel through your material. So our system is finite, in this direction, but also the transducers are finite in this direction. We've got a finite number of scatterers as well. They're not non-zero in size, they're not point scatterers. Whereas the structure that we use for our multiple scattering model are represented on the right-hand side, which is that we usually use a semi-infinite cast space. We'll look at an incident plane wave, where the wave number is k, or the wave vector, this is k, if I wrote it as a vector, and we then do our ensemble averaging on that. So you can immediately see differences between the theory and the reality. Now, what we're really doing when we apply the multiple scattering theory is to say, what is the effective material property? So whereas we have this structure which is our infinite half space, infinite number of particles, what we seek from that is an equivalent homogeneous material with new properties, and it's those properties that we derive from our multiple scattering model. So let's work through how this works for our system. So first of all, we would start by thinking about single particles themselves. We always treat them as spheres. Megan did do some work on some shaped crystals a long time ago, but generally speaking, we do treat them as spheres. And we are working in the Rayleigh regime, as I mentioned, but in our systems, we do need to account for the fact that the embedding medium, the water, the continuous liquid, can support both thermal and shear waves, as well as the compressional wave. So given the wave numbers up here, so the compression wave obviously written as the wave speed over here OEC, and it is attenuating. But there are also thermal waves, so this is a temperature-dominated compressional wave, a longitudinal wave, whose properties depend on the conductivity, heat capacity of the material. And we also have sphere waves. Now in a solid, so for the particle, the sphere wave has this wave number. But in a liquid, it is also dissipative. These two are dissipative waves, which means the real part is equal to the imaginary part of the wave number, which means that they are very lossy. You lose most of the energy in that wave over a wavelength. And so when we solve the single particle scattering problem, we are using the multiple expansion, as I've written here. So this, some of this will be familiar from earlier in the week. Here we've got our Legendre polynomials here, but we've lost one part of those because of the symmetry of the problem, the planar incident wave. We've got either a p-matrix solution here, or you might call this a scattering coefficient. And we are able to solve this for the scattering coefficients. And we would be solving for the coefficients of the shear wave, the thermal wave, and the compressional wave in both of those materials. So just linking back to earlier in the week, we talked about the foldy solution. Those were isotropic scatterers. We're not treating these as isotropic, and neither are we treating them as points, so they can have finite size. But we do limit our multi-toplet functions in the Rayleigh regime up to order one, sometimes we include two, and really we can get away with just zero and one. So let me show you what those look like. I'll try to maintain a convention of the wave coming in from the left. And that shows you the shape of a couple of the lowest of the tolerant expansions. And so here we've got the monopole mode, and we're showing here temperature. So these are the temperature fluctuations that we see around the particle. And on this one, this is sunflower oil. You can see it's intensified inside the particle. Essentially, the temperature difference is bigger inside the particle. So this is sometimes called a breathing mode because it represents that spherically symmetric oscillation. But it also acts really as a monopole kind of temperature oscillator as well. So you've got some that produces the thermal wave, which is also a monopole in nature. But here we've also got a dipole. So in this case, I'm looking at silica in water, which is going to give us our dipole contribution in the multipole expansion, and that is orientated in the direction of the displacement of the incident wave, which is in this direction. So here I'm showing the Z component of the velocity. These are pinfold simulations, but they match exactly the analytical field maps we did it. So you can see some asymmetry between the forward and the now, often in a lot of the food systems that we're interested in, they are designed to be stable, and that means that they have a very similar density to the particles and the surrounding liquid. So often this dipole term is very small for those systems, so we see this effect mostly when we're looking at solid particles. Okay, so let's just build up the multiple part of the multiple scattering theory then and show you what happens there. So we start with the single scatterer coefficient. We place scatterers, so this is the deterministic multiple scattering, where we know where all of the scatterers are placed in space. And we add up all of their scattered fields. We work out what the local exciting field is on one of those scatterers. And then the new trick, which is to, new in the sense of it goes further than the deterministic scattering, which is to fudge things rather and say, okay, let's take an average over all possible ways that we could put those particles in space. And so that will be affected by the statistics of how the particle structures are distributed. You then need some kind of closure approximation in that system of equations, which I'm not going to talk about. I mean, some people here are very interested in closure approximations. But the outcome of the process is the effective wave number of the material. So what we have here is then a characteristic property for our material that we can use to describe behaviour in terms of ultrasonic propagation to describe the behaviour. And essentially that is an effective speed and an effective acceleration are both within that effective wave number. And those are the two things that we can measure in our system. Now we tend to use the low concentration expansion of that as well, for convenience really. And so that gives us a form where the effective wave number is just a series expansion in the number density of particles. We tend to work with volume fraction rather than the number density as such. And then if we look at the terms in this expansion, we would have the single particle scattering term, which is the first order in concentration, which depends on the scattering coefficient. And that would be a summation over all of the different scatterer types as well. So if we've got mixtures of particle sizes, mixtures of different materials in there, we can just add what goes up in that first order term. And when we get to second order, things get rather more complicated, and I'm showing you the expression that was derived by Art Gower and co-workers here, which was part of a project that we worked together on a few years ago. And so this is very nice because this allows us to work with different scattering types, and this is a summation which involves the translation and addition theorems which have been referred to for the scattered field. And somewhat simpler, I like this version because it's nice and short. So in the Rayleigh limit, we can reduce that for the second order of concentration, and also using only the monopole and dipole scattering terms, so that we end up with a series which is limited. And effectively, we replace all of the scattering coefficients or T matrices by their number averaged values, so a weighted average of all the species in the system. And so we end up with something which gives us our effective wave number, which, as I said, improves the effective speed and the attenuation. And that is a function of the concentration psi here and all of these scattering coefficients or T matrices. And I haven't been very consistent on whether that is a Z or a T, but you'll figure this out, I'm sure. And then there's a little extra bit on the end here, which I will come back to later on, which is something to do with the multi-mode scattering. So now I'm going to hand over to Megan, who will tell us a bit about the measurement system and how we actually use this in practice. So there's that bit. I think we're going to use it as an action. Yeah. So it's a longitudinal wave mode. It's a solution to a Helmholtz equation if you include thermal conduction in there. But it's a wave which decays very rapidly. So it decays in a wavelength or so. So it's only generated at boundaries. You don't tend to send a thermal wave, although you could if you had an oscillating temperature source. But because there's a mismatch in the properties of the particle and the surroundings, the particle itself wants to change temperature due to the compression by a different amount than the liquid around it. So effectively, you've got a really point source in temperature, fluctuating temperature, which drives this temperature wave. So basically, the compression wave is the pressure-dominated wave that has temperature fluctuations in it. The thermal wave is temperature dominated but also includes pressure fluctuations. They're both longitudinal, but we only see the thermal wave at these temperature boundaries. Okay? Right, over to you.
Thank you, Valerie. Okay, I'm going to illustrate this slide or decorate it with a number of experimental systems. However, I've chosen the experimental systems in order to illustrate the practicalities that you have to face when you're making acoustic measurements in order to get data which we can actually interpret using these partial wave series that Rayleigh developed years ago, 1890s. Okay, so here's the first one. So what I've chosen this for is to first of all show the actual construction of a piezo transducer. It's actually fairly complex. So we have a piezoelectric element which is excited usually by a large pulse, a voltage pulse. But this was say a 2 megahertz element, so the resonant frequency of the probe of the element is defined by its elastic properties of its thickness, so operating in a thickness mode. At the back is a multiple scattering absorbent layer,
usually an epoxy, red filled epoxy or something like that, and that element prevents the backward wave so that you reduce reverberation in the finite disc that's generating the sound pulse. So we hit it with a pulse and then it goes like that. Now what I'm going to point out here is that the field in front of the transducer is far from uniform. So we have very close to the transducer fence, we have what's called the region of confusion. This arises because you have finite at the edges, the transducer is going like that. So you actually generate waves that are moving across the face of the transducer, and these mix with the outgoing wave that we're trying to work with to generate this rather complex region. Then we have what's called the near field. I'm going to look at this in a bit more detail, but in the near field, the amplitude of the signal varies very rapidly. However, the beam is well collimated, so the diffraction manifests itself in terms of amplitude oscillations, and we'll come back to that in the next slide. Then we have the focal region, and it's important, as you'll see, to realize this is a focal region. The focal region is the region where at all points the phase is equal. And then outside that we have diffraction, the beam spreads. And clearly if we're making a measurement, we have to worry about what's happening to all of this. And then it actually is more complex than that. So these are simulations that Nick Parker did using a finite element modeling. And so these pictures are slices of the beam, so they're the amplitude variations in a slice at a squared over 3 lambda. So x over a is the focal point. And you can see we have these very complex field patterns. We have lobes, so the actual field pattern is quite complex. And here you can see the focal region, and then you can see that as the beam spreads out, then we have diffraction effects that we have to worry about when we're making the measurements. And at the back here is the axial amplitude plotted against x over a. Okay, now the next thing is, you know, we've been talking a lot about working with Fourier transforms. Most of our measurements, not all, but most of our measurements are made with pulses. And this is this is a 7-cycle tone burst. What you can see, first of all, it's amplitude. Right, so the point to be made here is, first of all, that this is a pulse. Typically, say for a 2 megahertz, transducer, this would be around 3 to 4 microseconds long. So this also means because it's traveling at the group velocity. Okay, so the group velocity is. Okay. So it's traveling at group velocity, so it occupies a region of space. So it's a bit like, it behaves a bit like a particle. So in fact, what we're seeing here is wave-particle duality. And we have to worry about the relationship between the spatial extent of the pulse and the size of the measurement system. Because, for example, if we put this pulse into a small system where the front edge starts to reflect before the back edge has left the transducer. In other words, it's filling the volume of the measurement system. Then the leading edge will reflect, and that reflection, it may be phase reversed or it may not. So the wave that's coming back begins to interfere with the forward going wave. So we have to worry about a experience problem as well. So all these have to be built into the experimental design. This is another experimental system that we're now working with a lot. Based on work that we did about 20 years ago, they'll call it a frequency scanning ultrasound pulse echo reflectometer, or and the way this works is we have a buffer rod in front of the transducer, and we deliberately design this so that we get reverberations in the buffer rod. And those, some of those reverberations leak into the measurement, into the sample we're trying to measure, and they bounce around inside the sample as well. And we can compare the reverberation in the buffer rod, where we know the properties, material properties, so we know the speed of sound, we know the nature of the pulse that we're working with, we know the temperature dependence of the speed of sound in the buffer rod, and we can measure the reflection coefficient, the complex reflection coefficient. We can measure the speed of sound in the sample, and so we can actually determine density from the impedance. So we can determine the impedance here. We've got the speed of sound in the sample, so we can get the density of the sample out as well. So this is, we're using this a lot to look at crystallization. This is a pulse system. I'm going to show a quasi-continuous system shortly. So we can change the bandwidth of these pulses by changing the bandwidth of the transducer. So if we want a broadband, we reduce the bandwidth. This is a relatively broadband transducer, half a megahertz, half a megahertz to 6 megahertz. But these systems we've run up to 100 megahertz or 200 megahertz. Basically, the system scales. Resolution goes up as 1 over frequency, but the penetration goes as 1 over, goes as frequency squared. So, I think as we increase the frequency, we can't penetrate far enough, so we lose resolution faster than. I'm just going to stop trying to make me say that and move on because I'm. Right, so this is a system that we use to look at temporal and spatial evolution of colloidal systems. So we're interested in how the particles interact and move under gravity. So we have, in fact, this is Valerie's PhD, actually modeling the sedimentation or greening of the particles and looking at models so we can actually predict how the systems are going to clean, because we're trying to predict their shelf life, predict their stability. But here, we send a pulse through the sample, and hopefully it's going to do that for me. Right, that only took me about 2 hours. And we move the front probes up and down. So we can make measurements over days, weeks, months. We can follow the evolution, the spatial evolution of these specific particles. And then we can use these scattering theories to determine particle size at each point, the concentration of the particles at each point in space, and other things as well. So this is moving on. This is a what we it's an ultrasound attenuation spectrometer. It's a schematic of it. It operates between about 2 megahertz and 120 megahertz. And the way it works is that it generates a very well-defined frequency. It then, that is then transmitted by the right-hand transducer into the system. So there are actually two sets of transducers. There's a low frequency one here, and there's a high frequency one. So the low frequency one will work up from about 2 to 12, 15 megahertz. This one will work from about 10 megahertz up to 120 megahertz. The two transducers overlap in frequency, but you build, what you do is you build up what is, you do not want a standing wave to build up. So you can only allow the wave to build up enough to fill the space, but not enough to generate a standing wave. Because what you're going to do is, what you're going to do is move the transducers. And if so you can determine how the amplitude of the signal varies with distance, and you can determine how the phase of the signal varies with distance. This is not such a good way of measuring the phase, actually, but it's a very good way of measuring the amplitude. And in that way, you get an attenuation spectrum. And I'm going to show you some in a minute. This is my latest incarnation. These are using catch ultrasound to characterize soils. And the ultrasound system is being carried on an agricultural robot. And it's going around the field, dropping the transducers on the ground. And then we measure the time of flight between the two transducers. And interesting things like if you go in the field, you'll find cracks in the soil. So we can actually measure the depth of cracks. But more importantly, we can tell about the water content and other things. So this is taking up quite a bit of my time at the moment. I have now a certificate in driving robots. So this is the experimental data, and basically scattering theory works. It works really well. It works so long as you're in the long wavelength limit. So here's some data. This is from a long time ago, Chen and I, Herman and the planets. This is showing how is this the same data? Yes, it is. Yeah, so these are the particle size. So we've got two particle size distributions which have been combined into this attenuation. And you can see the agreement is very complicated. And if we don't put the thermal zone in, this doesn't work. There's a very big difference in thermal difficulty and heat capacity between the continuous and dispersed phases in water. So you get these very, very large temperature gradients, but they're oscillating and they are not propagational. This is more data. This is from one of my papers, which is surprising. So we use silicon water a lot to calibrate the system, so it's 320 nanometers. Just drawing your attention, this is a upward tempo theory. It doesn't work quite so well as so the dots are theory and the solid line is the experimental data.
So you can see it works very well. Here's work from Valerie's group. One of the issues is at what point does the time limit break down? So we were comparing different instruments. So you can see basically different instruments all fit the theory very well. Okay, this is Bovine theorem argument. We treat it as a point. Right, and the point I want to make is there's something really, really complicated like that. We can treat as a spherical scattering. And when we do, we can determine its adiabatic compressibility, which, as far as I know, nobody else bothers about, even when they're doing molecular simulations. Although the compressibility is an output of these simulations, it seems to me that we can use acoustic measurements to calibrate these quantum mechanical simulations. So just quickly, I'm just going to keep going. Sorry. Don't go too slow for me. Right. Okay, so dilute long wavelength scattering model. So we can apply this to the attenuation difference and the inverse square of the difference in the velocity of sound in the continuous phase and the solution. And the speed of sound in the liquid gives us the adiabatic compressibility. So moving quickly on, if we plot this for bovine serum albumin solution, we get a very nice fit between the inverse square velocity and the volume fraction. And it's very important when you're talking to biochemists that it's the volume fraction that we get out here, because these systems are built out of weight concentrations, so you have to know the partial molar volume in order to do this. So these are sort of the data we got. The filled triangles are compressibility. So as we move the pH from acid to alkaline, the molecule gets negative compressibility. And this negative compressibility is arising from the interaction between the solvent, water, and the molecule. And the molecule has a complex structure. Actually, the water is in a rather complicated way and up into the molecule, but we can see all of this. We haven't published this work, although we are very confident about it, because the biochemists don't believe it. Anyway, so these are the sort of things you have to deal with. Right, finally, I think for my bit, this is data on crystallising copper sulfate solution. Here we have the velocity of sound plotted against time. So what we've done is crash cooled the solution, so it's super saturated. We're measuring the speed of sound all the time, and in this region it's called the dead zone. No crystals are growing, but you can see the speed of sound changing. And then in this region, crystals are appearing, and we can use that previous equation to determine the volume fraction of solid material that is present. And if we do this, what we see is solid appears. This is the dead zone here. No crystals to see, but solid appears, solid goes. Solid appears, solid goes. These are the critical fluctuations that you get in the dead zone in a crystallizing system. And the red line is the 15 points of HP Golling average, because of course that average should be zero, because there are no crystals. What's happening is solid material appears here, then it disappears.
solid material appears there and it disappears. We're doing an average in time, so the pulse is probably 4 to 5 microseconds long. So each pulse measurement is measuring the amount of solid in the beam during that time window, and we can change that time window. This is plotted against relative supersaturation, and at this point we get uncontrolled pressure growth. And of course the interesting thing from the scattering point of view is that how do you treat scattering theory for objects that are transient, because that's what we're seeing here. So that I think is interesting multiple wave scattering problem.
Right, so let us continue. I'm just going to step back a bit. I promised to return to the theme of the thermal and sphere modes. So here goes. Let's talk about multi-modes and how multi-modes pattern in our system. So I told you earlier you've got all of these scattered waves represented in by the blue circles here. These are our scattered pressure waves, the compression waves that you're familiar with as acoustics. But also, I mentioned that we've got thermal and sphere waves which are dissipative, so they decay very close to the particles at which they are created. Now, we've shown you already in Megan's section that multiple scattering theory works really well. And if I can generalise the conditions in which that happens, I would say large particles, low concentration, as long as you're still within the Rayleigh limit. But what happens then if our particles are actually quite close together? By close together, I mean that the wavelength of the thermal and shear waves that are produced when you scatter at one of these particles, that wavelength becomes similar to the gap between these particles. Now then we've got some interesting effects, because so far our multiple scattering model that we've been using only accounts for the multiple scattering of those pressure waves and not for the multiple scattering of those thermal and shear waves. And you get some interesting effects that happen. So what we observe is that in general the attenuation decreases as we increase the concentration. I should be more specific. It decreases relative to the theoretical prediction from the pressure-only multiple scattering. So here's our prediction from a Loughborough or Linton Martin or Waterman Tool multiple scattering model. And here are our experiments. And this is the same system that we showed you earlier, where multiple scattering theory worked well. But now we are at higher concentration, and we have a significant problem here. Similarly, for 20%, so it's not quite so bad here, but as we go up in concentration. If we move instead to solid particles in water, again, here we're looking at attenuation against frequency. So this is our prediction of the Loughborough model, and here are our experimental data. This is silica in water now for much smaller particles. Previously we showed you 1,000 nanometers. These are only 214 nanometers and at a higher concentration. So because this is volume fraction, this is actually nearly 40% by weight, which is a very high concentration for a solid in water system. I think I'm going to cover this, I can come back to it in questions. So the key parameter which is determining this problem is the length scale comparison between there are two really, between the wavelength of the thermal or shear wave and the size of the particle, or the gap between the particles. So that gives us an opportunity, and now there is a theory which is used here which improves our prediction quite substantially. So this was the 2012 paper, which was really the first attempt to incorporate the effects of multiple scattering of those thermal and shear waves. There's been a recent update, And one of my tasks over the next few weeks is to go through this in detail and apply it to these systems and see how it improves things. But the key parameters that we use is the dimensionless shear wave number if we're looking at a solid particle in a liquid system, or the thermal dimensionless wave number for liquid systems. But that gives us an opportunity, because that scattering of those other modes occurs mostly when those particles are close together. So that means that we can tell if particles are on average closer together than they would be in a random distribution. So let's have a look at particle correlation now. And this is simulation rather than experiment, I'm afraid. So this is sunflower oil and water, and we've constructed a cluster of particles. Here it is, 7 particles. And we worked out what the thermal and viscous power dissipation is within the simulation region. As a function of the distance between the particles normalized on the thermal wavelength. So we think that thermal scattering is the predominant effect in the system. And what you should be able to see by these dots is that as we increase the distance, so we pull the particles further apart, we increase the power that we dissipate. So conversely, as we bring the particles closer together, we're not dissipating or losing as much energy as we expected to. So there's some reformation of that scattered acoustic energy that previously we lost because it was just dissipated near the particles. We're actually reframing that when the particles become closer together as we reconvert it back into an acoustic mode that is included in our measurement. And we can see in practice that this does happen. This is an example of an oil and water emulsion. This is a slightly complicated mechanism which I can talk to you about over a cup of tea. But essentially what we're doing is aggregating the oil droplets in an emulsion. And so if we look at these, this one here is nothing happening at all, no flocculation. But when we add another surfactant which generates this aggregation mechanism, the attenuation drops a lot, very sharply. So we've got aggregation and a decrease in attenuation, and then it all levels out. So thus, this is evidence that this is what happens. We can detect aggregation through the measurement of attenuation. So I'm going to bring it to a close at that point. So I think if I were to draw some conclusions from what I've said today, what we've both said today and what we've shown you, really that ultrasound can be a very rich source of information, both where it agrees with our standard multiple scattering models, and indeed where it doesn't, because there's lots of information there when it doesn't work, as it were. And actually for us, multiple scattering theory has been a great tool to help us to model and understand these systems, and also to actually characterise materials. What's the particle size, what's the concentration, what's the density of the material, how much crystal material do we have in our system. But I think it's important to remember those significant differences between an experimental setup and the models that you construct. You know, your infinite half space, point isotopic spectra, etc. Just be aware of the assumptions you're making and how they are impacted by your real practical setup. And just to note that I think the differences often will offer you the most interesting lines of inquiry because they are aspects of theory that are not yet solved, or they are aspects of your material behaviour that you can actually explore by using the ultrasound and using the multiple spectrum models. So I will leave it there, and I think David's going to jump in and offer questions to people.
Brilliant stuff, thank you. Fantastic. So, yeah, Luke.
Sorry, sorry. theory of 3D? No, there's a 3D as well. Yeah, so initially we start with, as you say, uniform rounding, but we do include the whole correction. In other words, you can't populate that excluded a volume of the structure itself, and then it's sort of pseudo roundabout some extent. So that's a bit of a fudge. When I first started working with those, I got told off for using the word random, so I'm hesitant to use it. Sorry, say that again, Bessie. Yes, they are log normal. That's typically what you get if you've got emulsions and solid particles. It's very common for us to have that form. Yes, they might be binodal, sorry, Paul. They can be binodal sometimes. Well, it depends on the system. In the most basic case,
we'd like to know the size distribution of the oil phase. You don't want too big a particle or a small cream, unless you like doorstep milk, then you just take the cream off. But we also want to know the size distribution of the protein, the casein. That's mostly important. It's important in terms of processing as well. But that's an example. Another example would be if you want to, one of the classic ways of stabilizing colloidal food is to reduce the size of the particles so that they are dominated by the diffusion, the Brownian diffusion curve, rather than by the density difference. And then again, it's very important. And by the way, you don't want a few big particles. So actually, if you're using both light scattering and ultrasound, in the light scattering, the big particles dominate the scattering. In the ultrasound, it's the small particles actually scatter more strongly. So the two are complementary.
Yeah, I mean, I do tend to think in terms of energy. I mean, these are complex as well, aren't they? So, you know, adding and subtracting is a bit, yeah. I think again I have slightly different patients of that. But one thing, going back to what you were saying about adding and subtracting, if you look at the two particle problem, there will be an asymmetry effect. So as you move the particles away from each other, you will see an oscillation in the field amplitude, depending on the distance compared to the wavelength. Yeah, the overall dissipation only gets smaller as you bring them together. As far as we know, I mean, I showed the data points there. I haven't looked in between the data points, so maybe I should.
You've got lots of little particles. You've got a certain effect being important because you've got more surface area for the mass of each particle. As you bring them together, aggregation, effectively, it's like a big particle. As you make them more support, you can be less of that until the aggregation goes down. Especially in the geometrical aspects and for 3D and multiple. So I wonder if the very special geometric aspects of these things are what are affecting your variation of results from the particles that closer together. I just wonder if you have any particular view for the specific metric that's coming and the particles get close.
So one of Megan's PhD students did the two particle problem with the thermal field and not the serial wave field. And you can, if you do that, you can see very clearly how the temperature and mass kind of joins these two particles together, as it were. So we have some information about that. We haven't done it for the serial wave field yet. But yes, I think that must be absolutely critical for the overall attenuation when you do the ensemble average. But we haven't got field maps really locally at the moment for the multi-particle problem. No, we don't. But one thing that we just didn't have time to cover was that concept of how we got an ensemble average, because actually the system we're measuring is particles. And if you take a snapshot in time, those particles are in a particular set of systems. So in practice, when we take one measurement, how are we actually achieving an ensemble average? And we do that in a number of ways. One is to actually do averaging. So on the oscilloscope, we'll take a coherent average. And so, and because the particles are moving around by diffusion, then we are effectively averaging over configurations. So that's one sense in which we do that. There's also, I think, some spatial contribution to that, that we have, you know, finite transducers normal for the direction of propagation. So you're effectively sampling different regions of material in one snapshot. So that's another sense in which we have some kind of averaging going on there. But I think it's an interesting question how the formal ensemble average relates to what we actually measure in practice. So it's millikelvin if you're working at a fraction of the oil in atmosphere pressure information. Is that right? That's what you agree with that? Yeah.
think that's a good point. So, can we thank Megan and Valerie?